vibrant friends from different schools. Our own team, our Captain V.S. Rajkumar, who is Chief of Operations of Air India Express, Captain D.R. Gupta, Chief of Training of Air India Express, and our esteemed crew members, members from the media fraternity, Team B-World representatives, and all the staff of Bharati Vidya Bhavan, and dear children. On behalf of entire Air India Express family, which is headquartered in your own city, Kochi, I express my sincere gratitude to each one of you for being part of this wonderful event. And this is a very important day in the event calendar of Air India Express. I hope you all are aware about this airline, because I know you all are very airline enthusiasts. And you should be very proud about this city, because our city, the Kochi, has got many unique features. And one of the unique features now is we are, like, Air India Express is headquartered in Kochi. It's one of the youngest airlines of this country. And you should be amazed to know that this is India's first international budget carrier.
Whatever talk to you from the heart and is extempore. It's actually a great privilege bestowed on me and I guess all of us that we've been given an opportunity to interact with all of you. You know, I belong to a region of the country in North. The way I've been brought up, I think I have not realized as to what reality of India is. It was only when you meet kids, especially at my age, you realized how much the country has changed. Okay, so that's why I say it's such a great privilege bestowed on all of us to interact with all of you. And I would feel honored, privileged, if I could convince one of you to take up the job what we are doing. And what I can say is that it's a job, it's actually a dream job, and it would be for all of you if you actually join. It's an excitement, what you have, you go through it every day, and what you see, what you undergo every day is different. It's actually, every day is different. That's excitement. Doesn't get stayed. You don't never get, you get bored of doing the same job again and again. That's the good part about the job, what we do. And I mean, my job means all of us. It's the same thing. It's a teamwork we do. So it's all of us actually go through excitement each and every moment of our working. And now that we all here, we'll give you experiences. You can ask us any question what you have. Like what he said, could be exciting. Don't make us crazy, I'm sure. But we would love to have questions like that, which maybe I've not thought of it in all these years. I've been flying for the last 36 years now. Okay, so I've happened to be from Air Force. I was a fighter pilot then, did 20 years there, came here. So it's a job, it's a dream job for all of you, and you should definitely make an effort to get in here. Okay, Pragish has given you an overlay of what we do, and we will talk to you. You can ask us any questions, any doubts you have, and we'll try and answer as best as we can. I'm sure you guys are more brilliant than most of us, so you might put us on the back foot. I'm sure about that too. Okay.
Thank you, all of you. Mrs. Girija, Ms. Sri Jyoti, Ms. Rekha, and all the schools which could spare the kids to attend a meeting with all of us. It's very exciting to be with all of you, going to be soon young, fine ladies and gentlemen soon. I'd like to introduce myself. I was born in a small hamlet in an agricultural village, did my studies all close by, schooled out of a municipal high school, did college and started flying. As Captain Gupta said, when we were kids, we wouldn't know what an airplane is. And today, fifth class, seventh class students are asking about wind shear and stall. It's an exciting new world which has started here. Mr. Pragesh, who's been kind enough to organize this function and introduce you all to ask some questions about aviation. And all my colleagues here would also be very willing to take up any questions you all have. Please do shoot questions. We are there to answer all your crazy questions and get crazy ourselves. Thank you.
So, Captain, which are the airports that give you nightmares, and which are the best airports to land on? jitters is not related to airports, though. You know, all airports, if you see these days, are designed and catering for safety first. So the nightmares won't be related to the airport. It could be related to other issues which could be happening around at that particular point of time. And you're saying about good airports, all airports are good to land.
Yeah, as Captain Gupta said, there is airports don't give you jitters because we're all trained for safety and to conduct safe flights into all the airports. But there are certain airports which require a lot of additional preparation. Those are called critical airports. And one in Kerala is Calicut Airport, which is tabletop. And because of the topography, there are a lot of hills around it. So there are special precautions and additional training which goes through before a pilot attempts to land or starts operating out of that particular airport. One is Calicut. It's called critical airports. One in south, we have Calicut and Mangalore, both of them critical, which requires far additional training than other regular airports.
My name is Inia. I'm from class 8. I study in the same school. I have a question to the crew members. If a person or if in the passenger has some medical problems, medical emergency, what is your role to help them?
Okay, when we undergo our training, we were trained for first aid. Actually, we are actually a first aider. So whatever medical emergency comes, we are trained for that and we will handle it well. And in case if it is beyond our control, then the next option what we were taught is like we have to page for a doctor. If there is any doctor on board, then they have to assist us during the thing. If even the doctors are not available and if we still feel it is a critical thing, then we require a medical attention immediately, then we will inform the captain and we will decide to land into the nearest airport.
Okay, I'd like to add one more point here. Whenever it reaches the captains that a passenger is unwell, we consider even if it is one life, it is very, very critical. So we immediately decide to divert if we'll have to, if the passenger requires an attention. So we go to the nearest airport, whichever is available, and as per international conventions, all airports, whether friendly or not, permit emergency landings for medical cases. And they also take care of them as soon as they land.
My name is Neha. I'm from 7th, same school. So my question is to the captains. How do you fly in stormy weathers? And what are the difficulties that you will face and how do you overcome them?
Stormy weather is actually one of the challenges which a normal civil pilot faces. So during the design of the aeroplane itself, they design in such a fashion. Firstly, your aeroplanes are very well statically bonded. Secondly, they have very good weather radar given in the aeroplane. So use the weather radar to avoid the weather first. And in case you can't avoid it, then you find ways and means of basically narrow paths between the clouding or between the turbulent weather to negotiate your navigate between them and to avoid the path. That's what it is.
My name is Rohit. I'm from class 11, same school. Captains, which is more harder, recovering from a stall or negotiating, doing a landing during wind shears?
Normally a stall condition we won't encounter. We are training, you know, a pilot's life or all of us, we are trained continuously all through our life. It is one of the few profession I was talking to, I think Captain Rajkumar only today morning, in which case your training or learning doesn't stop, unlike any other profession. Most of the profession, you reach a level and it stops there because you're taken as you're a master of it. But as flying as a job, every 6 months, we have continuous training. That means even me and him, we still keep going through training, regular training. It's called recency training and checks, yes. It's not only training, it's even checks. So stall condition, normally one would not encounter at all. So you train for it to make sure it doesn't happen. And stormy weather, we land all the time. We just take precautions. There are, again, during training, and there are other methods involved, procedures involved, so that you avoid it to a certain level to keep safety in mind. And if it goes beyond it, then you don't land in that place. That's what it is. So it's absolutely safe. Even if you're flying aeroplane, you find a slightly turbulent, let me tell you that. It's actually absolutely safe, okay?
My name is Shruti. I'm from a Government Higher Secondary School at Pali. I'm class 12 student. I have a question for you, captains. What are pilots afraid of?
Yeah, as Captain Gupta said, we would be afraid of getting late, reporting late to duty, but we are generally on time. So, otherwise, all of us are afraid of gods, I suppose. And for pilots, weather is a god. So, yes, we do have a lot of respect for weather. And we are afraid of getting into stormy weather. And it's not only afraid, we do not get into stormy weather. That stormy weather, I mean, is called a cumulonimbus cloud. I'm sure all of you must have read through in your classes. Yes, none of the airplanes are capable of going into cumulonimbus clouds, and you're all afraid of them.
I'm Sumaya Sali, of class 12 from GHSS Edappally. My question is to Captain Sir. Pilots have many simultaneous responsibilities. Can you tell me about this?
Yeah, we have lots of them because, you know, we work as a team. And sitting in front, by virtue of the job what you're doing, you're designated as a kind of a team leader. So responsibilities fall in through that. You have a team to look after, firstly your team members, and they should be performing the way they're supposed to perform. And there is only one way of doing it. So you have your responsibility towards them, then you have a responsibility towards your passengers, which is the most important aspect. And then you have a responsibility towards your other crew members, which I would say is your engineers, which are on ground, your other commercial people who are ensuring, working hard to make sure all your passengers go on time and reach a place from A to B safely. So you basically need to carry the team and work as a team. That is the major responsibility.
Thank you.
My name is Adira Sarafin, plus one student. Have you experienced any calamities during flight?
We do. You know, like I was telling the few of the students I was meeting them, and I told you guys also, a job is exciting. All the time, there is something different happening all the time. It could be you saying about excitement. You could have a medical emergency on board. That itself is excitement because you planned, you've decided, you've been designated to go from one place to another place. So you have everything is chalked out and planned as per that. And today, if I have a passenger on board who suddenly falls ill, so I have to go somewhere else. So all my planning goes topsy-turvy. I have to replan it, and I have to take the passengers safe there and try and make it on time so that nothing unfortunate happens to the passenger whom you carry. Because life of, like Captain Rajkumar said, even one passenger is precious to all of us. That's what we train for, we groom for, we brief for, and we told, make sure that is sacrosanct. Okay, so that itself is excitement, I guess.
My name is Anaka. I'm plus one student. Is there any test for Lola and Blue to become a pilot?
To become a captain on a commercial airliner, it takes anything between 5 to 7 years from you started flying commercial airline or you started flying as a basic student. And yes, there are a lot of tests which are conducted for people who do not have experience and to enter flying. We have a psychometry test, we have a written exam test, we have a group discussion, we have an interview, and we have a simulator test. So all these tests are there for them before they can come and join an airline.
I'm Abdul Samad. I'm from GHSS Adapalli. I have a question for you all. There's a huge difference between girl commercial planes and boys commercial planes. Why is it so? And what do you have to say for the girls who wish to become a pilot?
I think it's a myth which is actually not required to be there at all. I don't think there's anything like that. There are a lot of lady captains, and for every Women's Day, we conduct the entire, we have the entire crew, the captain, the first officer, the ground duty staff, all of them being women.
Luke, I ask you to just look back on the screen.
Oh, that's... incidentally, my wife, who is also a captain. So there is surely no discrimination. There are a lot of women pilots, and there is no barrier. Women cannot make pilots, and all women are equally treated. And yes, as I said, there are a lot of captains who conduct the entire aircraft as women captains.
Morning, sir. My name is Rahul. I'm from class 6, Choice School. Sir, what was your first day like? Did it come up to your expectations?
The first day, as I was telling, I've come up a couple of you people. Today is incidentally my 25th year, for 25th year after I started flying. And it is very exciting. It may not have come up to expectations, yeah, as you're flying solo all the time, alone in the aircraft, so you're very very much concentrating on what you're supposed to do. So, but it is very exciting and it's a very memorable day, which I think I'm going to carry it through my grave.
So I'm Jake from 6th Choice School. So what is a black box? What activity does it record?
I'm sure half of the, most of you know it already. No? You're one of the, I think, youngest in this group?
Yeah.
Looks like.
Which class are you?
Sixth.
Sixth, he said. Okay, black box. I think I was talking to somebody. They already knew about it. It's actually not black, it's orange. That's a quiz question, isn't it? It's basically a data collection equipment. So all the data, whatever is happening on the aeroplane, in real time is recorded. And it's basic. And why it is kept there in the aeroplane is for analysis of, could be serious accident and incidents also, so that you don't prevent, basically prevent, so that you don't have it again and again. It's a prevention tool which is used by all airlines across the world to avoid any kind of problems which one could have in an aeroplane. And that data is then shared with all other airlines also, so that in case there is some equipment problem happening, so it could be shared with other airlines, they also could take preventive action so that doesn't happen. So that's the basic aim of having it. Okay.
I'd like to add a little more, demystify the black box thing. There are, it contains two parts. One is a digital recorder of all the parameters of the aircraft. The other one is a voice recorder, which is called the CVR, which you might have heard. So it records around 2 hours of the conversation, whatever has happened in the cockpit. It records parameters as simple as airspeed, altitude, and it could be from 5 simple parameters on smaller aeroplanes to hundreds in complex aeroplanes. So these are, apart from what Captain Gupta said, it also, these data are used to analyze what a pilot regularly common mistakes, which are used by his department for retraining people on those things which require additional training.
Captain, Miss Inia, she asked about the medical situation. Suppose what happens if there is a medical emergency. So we have a testimony here. So she will be just reading it for others.
Mrs. Dausa's experience in her own words. Halfway through the flight, my husband had breathing difficulties. Mr. George, the cabin crew, hope I have his name right, helped us throughout the journey holding the oxygen cylinder and assuring me and my husband. He never panicked. My husband had a tracheostomy and was breathing through a stoma in the neck. I have been with my husband in this condition for quite a while, but for a young chap like George, it might have been a relatively new case. But his assistance really requires a standing ovation. God bless him. The pilot also was so helpful by asking us if we require any emergency landing. Thanks for all the help and support. Last but not the least, the fellow passengers who were with us, praying continuously, relaxing his nerves, calming him. Regards, Reena Jacinta Zausa.
We should surely give them ovation.
My question is to the captain. Are you trained for situations like hijack and all?
We are trained for it because that is one of the situations one can encounter anytime. So there are proper procedures laid out. There are SOPs, standard operating procedures designed and devised, and they're disseminated and given to all the people who are working around on the aeroplane, because everybody has a different kind of a role to play under such situations. And one just hopes that one doesn't encounter it through the lifetime. Okay.
Thank you.
A little interesting thing for you that we all have secrets. Unfortunately, we have every day a secret code which is shared only between the captains and the cabin crew for the entry into the cockpit door. And this is primarily to prevent the hijack. And if you want to carry secrets for your lifetime, become a pilot or a cabin crew.
I'm from Choi School. I have a question to the cabin crew. I want to ask how you decided to take up a job that is risking your life and putting your life in front of, I mean, putting others' life in front of your life and trying to save their life and risking yours.
Yeah, that's actually a good question. Like, just the previous question was regarding the hijack. As you said, yeah, whenever there is a hijack, we risk our life because it's not only during a hijack, during any kind of situation when there is an evacuation or whatever it may be, we try to evacuate the passenger first. And for which, why did I prefer this job? It's because we are trained to do everything. And as she said, every job has its own risk involved.
It's one day it happens so, and you have to face it. And we are trained very well to do that. So, and every job carries its own risks. So I don't think so that we are risking our life every day. Like whenever any emergency comes, yeah, we think we can do it.
Thank you.
You visit many places, you open to many environments. You're not just into one place. Like if you're working in a company, you're just working in that company. You come to know about only little about those people and the culture over there. But when you are a crew, you go to many other places, you learn their culture, you come to know, you're exposed to many cultures, you can meet many people, you come to know, you try to become more observant. You observe things. So I think that brings changes in your life. So I think I have become a crew mainly because of this.
Which is quite exciting about cabin crew life. As I was trying to tell him, the hijack situation. As Captain Gupta said, we're all trained for hijack, and they also well trained for hijack. And it's one of the very few professions which tells your employee, in the interest of passenger safety, lose your life. Don't you agree? Yeah, as a cabin crew, it doesn't happen. As Amrita said, it doesn't happen. It never happens. But the training is such that in case of a hijacker points a gun on a crew to let an access entry into the cockpit, they would say no. The consequences of it is different. Immaterial what it is, they would still say no. That is what they train for. And this, I feel, makes their job very, very unique and very, very exciting as well.
I'm Rachel from Class 8, the Choi School. My question is to the pilots. How does a pilot learn to navigate a plane? And how long did it take you, Captain, to fly your plane alone?
Aeroplanes these days are actually super, they're almost like they have a lot of computers on board. So as far as navigation is concerned, ground-based people or ground-based systems get you a route. And it's a very complex system of routes made out by a centralized agency for all the aeroplanes which are flying all over the world. I could say it is like kind of a roads made out, highways made out. There are air routes which are made out in the air. And to stick to those routes, the systems these days are lots more and more complicated and automized. So as far as navigation concerned, it's a very simple system. You have different inputs coming from different sensors, which give it input to a computer, which generates one route and comes to us on a screen in front of us in the cockpit. So navigation is not so much a problem. You follow those routes, and you are on your route, what you are. And as far as training is concerned, it depends on to fly those navigation routes. Every time you're flying a navigation route only, you're navigating to go from place A to place B. But as far as to fly independently solo, it takes you about 32 trips. You have to go through those 32 trips in which you are trained, and then you checked out, and then you can fly on your own.
But suppose you're supposed to, like there's an emergency and you want to deviate the route. then?
So you're right. There are contingencies planned out for that in case you have to divert. Again, I would go to, in those cases, you have certain codes you declare on the RT. You understand the radio transmission. Yeah. So everybody else also is hearing at that point of time that some particular aeroplane has some emergency. Or in that case, everybody vacates that route and you have right of way and you can go directly to the base wherever you want to go on land. These are all international conventions which are designed, all countries have signed for it and everybody sticks to it.
Hi, my name is Lakshmi and I'm from the Choi School and I'm in fifth grade. So my question is to the pilots, like, how did you manage to learn all the controls in the cockpit? Like, it would be, if you could share it, it would benefit all those who want to become a pilot.
Hello, Lakshmi. Okay. their controls are there, and you're saying, how do you learn? It's a method of training which is devised by all the airlines. So how you transit is you initially start off on a small aeroplanes in which the controls are lots less. Yeah. So in that case, to compare it, it's like how you learn how to drive a cycle, go onto a scooter or two-wheeler, and then onto a car. So you find your controls are getting complicated from a bicycle to a car itself, isn't it? Similarly, then you go to aeroplanes, small aeroplanes first, which are very simple systems, and then you go to more uncomplicated. It's not too difficult, let me tell you that. It just needs a little bit more training. That's it. So like what he's saying, I forgot to tell you, there are lots of ground classes we have. There are a lot of training which happens on ground first before you get into the cockpit.
Thank you so much.
കേരളത്തിലാണ് ഏറ്റവും കൂടുതൽ ലിറ്ററസി റേറ്റ് ഉള്ളത്. പക്ഷേ ഈ ഫീൽഡിലോട്ട് മലയാളികൾ വളരെ കുറവാണ്. അതിനുള്ള കാരണം എന്താ സാർ? അത് അവയർനെസിൻ്റെ കുഴപ്പമാണോ അല്ലെങ്കിൽ മറ്റെന്തെങ്കിലും കാരണമാണോ?
Yeah, he is asking about is there any state kind of limitation, because he is saying that most of the pilots are from northern Indian states. Why there are minimum number of pilots coming from southern states like Kerala, Tamil Nadu and all?
There is no state limitations, and it's again a myth that there's not many Malayalis. There are a lot of Malayali pilots with us and with all other airlines, but probably many are not coming from states where the literacy rate is low because they're not well informed about this field, and it is a complex myth that including me, when I started flying, I would college was right next to a aerodrome, and we would see airplanes flying. So we would ask people, how to go there, and a lot of people said, no, it is not for us. It's for very rich kids and royals. So it starts like that, and today I'm sitting with you all and talking to you. So it is just a myth that it is only for certain states and certain people. It's only that we have to pursue, take it as a goal, pursue it, and we will find a way to go wherever we, not only as pilots, any or crew, or it's any field. We would reach wherever we want to go, provided we have that perseverance and an ambition to reach that point.
And Captain, taking examples from your life, is there any kind of barriers, language barriers, because it's a mix of students. There are students coming from government schools, CBSE schools, from international schools and all. So is there anything that limit students to aspire this profession?
To start with, it doesn't probably limit, the language doesn't limit, but most of the education, most of the documents are all in English. So eventually we'll have to learn to go through that, but otherwise to start with, it doesn't have any language barriers. So language should not be a barrier to start flying as a profession.
And what's your personal experience? Like, when did you just identify that, I'm going to become a pilot?
Mr. Pragesh said, when we were all kids, I just like to disagree with him on one point only. He would agree with what I'm going to say. He said, when we were kids, we used to make models of aeroplanes and boats and fly. Unfortunately, I still do. and I'm sure he does it. It's that earlier days, we did not know how to turn a paper model aeroplane. Now we know how to turn that aeroplane to the left or to the right, and what a small curvature, we'll have to put it on the wings on, and how to make it climb or how to go down. So that's what we keep experimenting. So it starts with very young age, but it is not that I started out to become a pilot. I did not know that I could even become a pilot. But yes, NCC gave me, I joined NCC in the college, and it gave me an opportunity to fly gliders. And once you get airborne, you're hooked to it. You just don't want to change your profession.
I'm a huge fan of the movie Sully, and the miracle on the Hudson River, I'm sure, inspired a lot of confidence of society in the entire flying community. So, sir, my question is, in such situations, how are the flight crew prepared for emergency landings on water bodies and large empty fields, sir?
Now, we've been talking about training all this while. You know, we have a simulator which all of us use it for our training. And it gives you very, very realistic kind of feeling to flying. It is exactly like an aeroplane. So you have visuals in front of you, which are also moving real time, and which is coordinated with your instrumentation in front, which happens in the air. So such kind of contingencies are people like us, him and we keep generating. As trainers, when you become, you generate and you keep training people for encountering one such situation, or maybe once in a lifetime, or maybe never in a lifetime, but you still train for them. So Sully, I guess, was also, what I know of, was a trained examiner in his airline, and he'd been training for it. So similarly, we train for such contingencies. We have regular meetings, we talk between each of us to figure out as to where one could improve the system, devise more and more contingency given to students or the other pilots, so that in case we encounter a situation like that ever, you are able to perform it the way he did.
I'd like to add a safety point here. All the aeroplane engines, big turbine engines, it's all tested for bird injection, what we say. And unfortunate incident on Hudson was that it took in a lot of birds. That's why an engine failed. Otherwise, generally, an engine doesn't fail with one or two birds going inside. And most of us had a bird hit during course of our career. So, otherwise, it is absolutely safe, and even if there are two engines fail, as Captain Gupta, the head of training, said, we all trained for handling situations like that.
You said that for emergency landings, you'll select the nearest airports in case of very emergency and all. So if you're flying through the water bodies, you'll not be able to locate any airports nearby. So that time, what precautions you take?
Okay. Yes, it's an interesting question. It's what we call oceanic routes, where there are not many airports where to go nearby and land. And one of them is medical emergency. The other one is the engine failing by itself, and we cannot continue the flight. So for that, what we have is a system called EDTO, Extended Diversion Operation Practice Procedures, you know, where the engines are all tested with to cover the entire ocean with, or the part of the ocean with one engine. And there is very stringent and stiff requirements to pass through those tests. And our DGCA has those requirements, and only airlines which meet those requirements are permitted to fly over long water bodies, or rather oceanic routes. So yeah, this answers your question. We all have different weights for takeoff, landing, and how many passengers we can carry and all these things. So it depends on, as if you do a long flight where you carry a lot of fuel, you cannot come back and land with the same fuel as your undercarriages. The wheels are not strengthened enough to accommodate that kind of weight. It is primarily why they can't do it. They can't do it because if you strengthen it too much, then there is more weight added to the aeroplane, and you would not be able to, it's a compromise between what you could do. So this is a very, very rare occasion that we have to come back and land, and if it is to be done, there are procedures where we jettison the fuel, we dump the fuel what we have already taken to reduce our landing weight to within our safe landing weight limitations.
My name is Ashwini Pradhi. I'm studying in 9th standard. I'm from GHSS Elamakkara. Ma'am, as a woman and as a cabin crew, you may have faced a lot of challenges. How do you overcome them?
Yeah,
I think she is asking about, you know, there are different kinds of passengers that you normally handle. So if there is a passenger who is breaking the limits and misbehave or create a situation, how do you handle such situations?
That's what I told her before. You become observant. Whenever a passenger boards, when you stand there to say your namaskar, you always look into the eyes of the passengers. So the passenger, when he comes in, from his, the way he starts till he reaches a seat, all the crew are very vigilant to know that how his attitude and behavior is. If he creates a problem then and there itself, we call the security staff to come and handle it, or we ask the ground staff, because the ground staffs are the one who handle them during the check-in time. So when they come to know, they handle it there itself. In case in flight, when he comes and boards the flight, and in case if it creates a problem like that, or if he's a drunkard passenger, or if because drunkard passengers also, and even passengers who are not mentally well, sometimes they come on board without informing. They will start showing such sorts of symptoms the time they board. That's what I told her, that we are really observant in whatever happens in flight. So in case if such a situation comes, we on ground, it's normally the tell the ground staffs or the security staff to handle it. And if it's there, if it's on board, then that also has a procedure. We first go and speak to him properly. In case if it doesn't go, then we go and tell the captain about it. So he gives a written letter, and we read that letter in front of him, along with means telling all the passengers that this is what has happened, and this is a written letter. It's a warning letter. Now, even after the warning, if he goes unruly, the only thing left is, if it's all four women cabin crew with the help of other passengers, we restrain him. We have a restraining device in the cockpit, and we use that restraining device to restrain him. Yes, it's a kind of handcuff. Yeah, so that answers the question.
So you're happy with the answer?
Okay. And normally, misbehavior doesn't happen. It's because once you're in uniform, nobody will dare to behave badly with you. Nobody. Because in a uniform, you are a mod of that airline. So nobody will do that.
As you're saying, it is a training, and their physical appearance changes what they train to make would disarm the passenger by itself. And generally, not many passengers, or rather almost everybody, doesn't misbehave. It is only in influence of narcotics, alcohol, or mentally ill passengers who generally misbehave. And a convention called Tokyo Convention. As per that, ICAO's standards, we also give a letter, and we are permitted to restrain them with plastic handcuffs.
Passengers who fly with the female pilots do not feel so safe as they do with the male pilots. So can you tell me something about that?
I surely not agree with that.
I'm sure definitely not agree. His wife is also a pilot. No, but
to become a pilot.
Yeah, that's not a correct statement. It's not that. And I don't think that statement is also right. And there must be very few people who must have made just casual remark like what you're talking about. That's just a casual off-the-cuff remark, which doesn't, it's not reality, that is for sure. So you should become a pilot. That's what I'm trying to say. Okay, yeah.
I'm Gangalal. I'm at 9th standard studying at GHS Elamakkara. And my question is, what are the areas that a crew get trained during the induction?
Okay, basic would be your ground training. We do that. Ground training is to be aware of the basics which go into your flying. And once you join a job, pick up a job, like I think most of you must be knowing, you need a license for flying. So there is a proper license which needs, and which has got two, three different categories. One license could be for flying, one is for operating your radio equipment. So these licenses are mandated by and world over. It's not only in India, by a regulator body which is there in all the countries. So when you go through these licenses, the first license makes you go through ground training, ground classes, to get you
to know as to how what flying happens, how flying happens, what it entails, and what can happen. So if you're aware of all that, and then you get into a cockpit, and then you get to know, get to learn about the controls as to what function what control does.
My question is to the crew. How should I groom myself to become an air hostess?
Good question. But it's all about your attitude. Whatever your attitude, you can apply to it. If you have a goal, set your dreams and achieve it. And you have to groom, it means you have to come from a standard school or a CBSE school or ICSE school. It doesn't state that. And it comes on your attitude, how you apply to your rules and basics, like that.
It's all depends upon our beauty, whether we are fair or something. It's all up to you, we are confident. If you are confident, a good communication skill, then what? You should be flexible, you should be adaptable to all situations such that.
My question is for cabin crews. Can you describe a situation where you are given the excellent crew service?
No, if you ask me, every time whenever I'm on board, I'm trying to give my best to the passengers. So if you ask me one specific thing, I think once, initially when I joined this airline, on my second year, we had an emergency, like we skidded off the runway. So during that time, passengers were really panicked. So I think I tried my level best to, you know, calm them down and, ease the situation.
So what is air pocket?
Okay, air pocket is a kind of a common man term for turbulence. So what we call, there are various kinds of turbulence which one would experience in the air. Particularly what they call air pocket is called a clear air turbulence, which is not identifiable on a weather radar, or we have no equipment to isolate and identify clear air turbulence. It's basically, it is updrafts and downdrafts in the atmosphere, which is caused because of pressure changes, atmospheric temperature changes, and also local winds. It could have up to around 8,000, 9,000 feet per minute rate of climb, or it could give your aircraft up to 8,000 or 9,000 feet rate of climb in that short period. So that creates those turbulence where they say the aircraft fell off from 35,000 feet. Yeah, where if you remove this cloud and all this just happens without the cloud, that's called the clear air turbulence.
What kind of insurance we take for flight?
You don't have to, you can personal insurance you can take, but
no,
otherwise
for the flight.
Okay, all aircraft seats are covered by the international regulation. So every airline ensures that every seat is insured as per their area of operation and their nature of operation. So it varies from aircraft to aircraft, but and country to country, but there is a minimum set limitation by the ICAO and IATA.
I have the question to captains. How do you communicate with the basement people of the destination airport? And if the bad weather is there, bad connectivity, or how do you face it? And another options for communicating with them?
Yeah, as I agree, we have various types of communication. One is VHF communication, which is a short range. It covers around 250 nautical mile, roughly around 450 kilometers from the station where we want to communicate. The other one is a HF communication, which is long range communication. We communicate through that over oceans. And the other one is a satellite communication, where it is done through the data from the computer, and we communicate to the aircrafts or the ground station or the controllers through satellite communication. And interestingly, there is an area in the sky where there is no communication possible with anybody as well. So, yeah, it is there.
Good morning. My name is Joshna. I am from KVINS Dronacharya. My question is to Captain. You have been flying as a commercial pilot. How does it feel being responsible for the life of 200 people on board?
Yeah, it's an interesting question. Yeah. How does it feel means we are responsible for those 200. There is no two ways about it. And because of that responsibility, we train for it because we know it's a serious job that we're doing. And why I say this, like I think I mentioned this earlier, because of this responsibility which is bestowed on us, our training does not stop throughout my life till the time I retire. It's one of the very few professions, and every 6 months, everybody is trained and checked out, no matter what you are. If you have to go into the cockpit, you have to be trained for it, and then you have to be checked out for it. I'll give you for the example, you could be a doctor. Once you become a surgeon or something, there's no one to check you after that. You do your MD or FRCS, whatever it is, there is no more test after that, unless you want to. But in our profession, you just continuously train and being checked for it. And the reason for that is because of being responsible for so many lives.
My question is to the cabin crews. So what are the various designations in your job, and what is the highest level of promotion in your job?
Okay, various designations in the sense, we join as a cabin crew, and it goes like after 5 years, you will be, if your records, everything is clear, then you will be promoted as senior cabin crew. Then you will become a cabin crew in charge, then a check cabin crew. And we have a post called base manager, which can be opted from any of the check cabin crew. So this is the maximum hierarchy, as if.
Okay, there is no limit. The sky is the limit. It depends on what are the vacancies and what we are trained to perform, and if those vacancies are available, there is only the sky is the limit. You know, one of them could end up being the chairman of the company or the CEO of the company sometime soon. Yes, there's only the sky limit, and he is one of the senior most with us. He is currently a CSTM, and he is responsible for all the cabin crew training. And he's still young, so he's got a long time to go.
My question is to the captains. How can I become a pilot, a commercial pilot?
First thing is you need to have the drive and the perseverance that I need to become one. So you need to decide. Once you decided, and so I hope you're a science student. That is the mandatory requirement. After that, it's not too tough. It's just you need to be in the books a little bit. You have exam, like I said earlier, there are licenses. You need to clear those. Once you acquire those licenses, then you need to apply for a job, like a normal regular job. It's not difficult. It's just basic thing why I'm saying is because at times you don't happen to have science as a background. If you have a science background, basic maths is mandatory.
Maths and science.
So that is mandatory. So not exactly a state-sponsored, which is started off like a state-sponsored institute, IGRUA. It is somewhere close to a place called, it's a state, UP, you heard of it. In UP, there's a place called Rai Bareilly. It's western UP side. There's a school which is opened by late Mr. Rajiv Gandhi. He opened a school basically dedicated for people to become pilots. So you go after 12th, if you could join there, they give you a degree in aviation. Alongside, you train and you become a pilot there itself. And they also ensure that you get that initial license called CPL, Commercial Pilot's License. So they train you for that, they teach you for that, they do your ground studies for that, and they almost ensure that you become a pilot there. And I don't think it's too expensive. I'm not too sure about the figures, but I don't think it's too expensive now.
Yeah, they have state subsidies and scholarships. And whichever school you decide to join, you should make sure they're DGCA approved. That is one of the basic requirements.
My dream is to become a pilot. Can you suggest the best course and the best institution to pursue my studies?
I think most of your question was answered with your other friend. And as Captain Gupta said, you need to have a mathematics and science in your up to your 12th standard. And thereafter, you join a flying school, a DGCA-approved flying school, and clear those ground examinations conducted by them. And then you start flying, get your CPL, and apply for any job.
What are the privileges you get as a cabin member of the Air India Express?
Yeah, best hotels we used to stay, and we used to get seeing places, and we can even interact with many passengers, in which celebrities, yeah, which includes celebrities and even politicians. Recently, we flew CM of Kerala from Calicut. So, you know, these are the privileges we get.
Apart from the other privileges, like take your family and
friends. Yeah, and yeah, we get, being in this company, we get a free passage tickets. So with that, we utilize to take our family abroad. No, these are the privileges.
How do you know when it's safe to put the plane on autopilot? Like what are the things that are needed in the weather for it?
You are very emergency conscious student. She's asking all questions about emergencies only. So it's a technically a devised instrument or equipment which is designed by a manufacturer, and he lays down some limits. That means you will not engage it below so and so height. So those limitations are catered, and everyone knows about it, and you don't engage below that. So the aeroplane is supposed to be trimmed, and there's a height limitation. Trimmed means your control surfaces which are moving. There should be in some stability factor that should be there in that. And the height limitation is because the equipment, when you engage it, could move it up and down a little bit. So that's where you have a little bit of height limitation, but it's all given by the manufacturer.
When do you go for a belly landing?
When you go for belly landing, as we hardly go for belly landing, there's nothing called belly landing. Only on emergencies, particularly when we do a water landing. And if the landing gear doesn't come out by itself, and it is stuck inside, so there is no other way to otherwise to go for a belly landing.
I am a commerce student, so what are the qualifications? Is it necessary for a science student? Is it necessary that should be a science student?
To become a cabin crew? No.
Then what are the qualifications?
You are 10 plus 2. Yeah, graduate. You need to be a graduate.
For which degree?
Any degree. Yeah.
I've heard that for somebody to become a pilot, you need to qualify an interview. So can you tell me about something about that?
Okay, generally in the interview, your personality is tested. As Karan Gupta said, first it starts with the attitude. Then your technical knowledge about your subjects are tested. Then your attitude to be flexible and fly various conditions are being analyzed by somebody else. And the interview primarily consists of these things, and there'll be some general knowledge questions, there'll be world questions, and yes, it covers generally 50% from technical, other 50% from non-technical side of you.
So is it required for somebody to become an engineer? After that only you can take a pilot license?
No, it's not required. You just need to be a 12th standard with maths and physics. Yeah, and you could join a flying school and do your course.
So what about the pilot aptitude test?
Pilot aptitude test is conducted by the school. We don't conduct it in the airline because you already come out as a commercial pilot from a flying school. So we don't again conduct a pilot aptitude test. But yes, we have a simulator test to check your flying skills. That is also, you could call it as a pilot aptitude test.